Hello and welcome. And it's not all bad news in the world of emulation. Today, I bring you some good updates, a brand new Nintendo 3DS emulator for Windows and Android, tests on the latest version of the beloved CEMU for Android, the emergence of three new forks to continue the Ryujinx legacy, with one already offering daily builds. And for fans of classic and arcade games like me, two long-dormant emulators have just received new versions packed with improvements. Before we start the video, leave a like to support the creation of more news compilations like this one. And if it's your first time here, consider subscribing to the channel to stay updated on all the latest emulation news and releases. Let's start with the big release of the week, Panda3DS. I've analyzed almost everything this emulator has to offer, both on Windows and Android. To set expectations, this is just a preview of the project, and it may disappoint due to lacking basic features, but it also impresses with what it already manages to do. First, let's talk about the Windows version. There's currently no way to improve internal resolution, and neither sound nor controller support has been implemented. I tested over 10 games, and the only one that didn't work was Resident Evil Revelations. One of the main issues with the Windows version is its inability to display pre-rendered cutscenes, the ones in video format. Some 2D games also have rendering issues with certain layers, like in New Super Mario Bros. 2. On the positive side, despite running on OpenGL, shader compilation stutters were quick and rare. Anyone who remembers the early days of Switch emulation running on OpenGL knows how slow and frustrating that process could be. There seems to be a way to switch to Vulkan via configuration file, but I didn't explore that option as I'm not sure how well Vulkan has been implemented yet. Overall, the emulator seems extremely fast, smooth, and accurate, but it still lacks basic functionality. Now, the Android version gave me a bit of a headache. First, there's no VSync option, so the app locks the display refresh rate at 120Hz on my device. It would have been easy to get the games running at 100% speed by limiting the device's refresh rate to 60Hz, but the app overrides that setting, forcing the games to run at 120fps. So, with no solution, the games were sped up. On the bright side, I tested three games that did run at 120fps. But hold on, it's not all perfect. Audio hasn't been implemented in the Android version yet, and pre-rendered cutscenes don't work either. However, unlike the Windows version, there is controller support, meaning you can play without relying on on-screen controls. Panda3DS is still a valid option if you're having trouble with Lime3DS or another Citra fork. Overall, it's better to use more established projects, but Panda is something I'll be keeping a close eye on, bringing you all the updates. The download links for all the projects mentioned in this video will be in the description. Now, regarding CEMU, it also brought a new update, which includes performance improvements and fixes for some games, but it also reintroduced an old issue. Among the performance gains, Bayonetta can now run smoothly, reaching 60fps most of the time, even on a Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. Graphical improvements were made in Sniper Elite 2, but unfortunately, it's currently impossible to progress in the game since the D-pad buttons were disabled in this update. This is a recurring problem in versions from the original developer, SSimco, but it will likely be fixed once the YGOMod version is released. Another issue that has resurfaced is the color rendering problem in some games, like Super Mario 3D World, though it only affects a few titles. Zelda Twilight Princess also saw a slight performance boost, but the mini-map issue persists, which can make navigating some areas difficult. Overall, problems like crashes in Bayonetta 2, improperly rendered objects in Yoshi's Crafted World, and performance issues in Zelda Breath of the Wild remain unchanged. As I mentioned, I hope that when the YGOMod ports this version, it will at least fix the D-pad issue, which renders some games unplayable, and resolve the color problems, as well as bring some quality of life improvements. Lastly, for fans of classic and arcade games like myself, FinalBurn Neo, an emulator for CPS1, CPS2, CPS3, Neo Geo, and other platforms, has received a new update after years without changes, since 2021. Although it's unclear what was changed in this update, I recommend you update it. If you're unsure how, you can access the GitHub page, the link will be in the description. Hopefully, this emulator will soon come to Android, where we face various issues with Neo Geo and arcade emulation. RetroArch has not been updated for a long time and is incompatible with Android 14, with noticeable issues in controller compatibility and overall performance. Another long-standing project that received a significant update was Flycast. This is a Dreamcast and Sega Naomi emulator and is currently the best free emulator we have for these platforms. Flycast has introduced many welcome updates, especially a complete overhaul of its interface, giving it a fresh look and moving away from that dated, early 2000s emulator aesthetic. Here's a quick overview of its improvements, retro achievements support. Improved interface with save-state thumbnails. Force feedback support for some arcade games. Discord-rich presence. Vulkan API optimizations. Numerous fixes and updates. Additionally, there are Android-exclusive improvements, such as vibration, the option to choose Adreno drivers, and some bug fixes. For those interested in downloading the latest version, it's currently available only on GitHub and will soon arrive in the Google Play Store. Now, let's talk about the icing on the cake. Ryujinx has died but has already come back from the dead, my friends. We even have new releases, and the team is already working on implementing the new firmware 19. According to a reliable Discord source, Alex Indy, there are at least 3 forks currently working with Ryujinx's code. But here, I'll highlight only Ryujinx Mirror, with its GitHub link in the description. This fork has already made some significant changes compared to the original Ryujinx, not so much in terms of performance, but there are already new commits in progress. The current focus is on merging Ryujinx with its LDN version, allowing online play over the emulator's private network without requiring another installation of the project. Additionally, they're working on other improvements, such as code cleanup. I'll leave the project's Discord and GitHub links for those interested, and I see a very promising future for this project. Let's just hope that this development team is serious and avoids the same mistakes that many Yuzu forks, like Sudachi and Suyu have made. And that's all for today, folks. Remember, all links to find the projects mentioned in this video will be in the first link in the description. There, you can find everything we discussed here for free. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.